Hello, I'm Florian Rommel, and welcome to my talk on our paper, Weight-Free Code Patching of Multi-Threaded Processes. As the title suggests, this work is in the field of dynamic software updating. This is the application of patches during the runtime of a program. Why would we want to patch during the runtime in the first place? Because we may not be able to shut down and restart the program. That may be the case in high availability systems, where service quality must be ensured, or in cases where a reboot is expensive. The prime example for this is operating system kernels. And indeed, for instance, there are several live patching solutions for the Linux kernel, which are actively used. However, today, not only operating systems have a huge boot up time, but also more and more user space programs. Think of server applications like big databases, which can have thousands of active clients. Yet for user space applications, runtime patching is only rarely used in practice, despite extensive research in this area in the past. Have a look at a typical server application, like OpenLDAP, for example. It consists of a listener thread that accepts a possibly huge number of client connections, which are then processed by worker threads. Now I want to patch some code that is executed by these workers. And this is where the problems begin. Before modifying the code, we have to somehow put all the workers in a state where the patch can be safely applied. Now, the code for the worker thread roughly looks like this in OpenLDAP. We wait for a new work package from the listener thread to arrive and then do the actual processing in the doWork function. Now imagine there's a bug in a function which may be called by doWork. Luckily, we have a patch that we want to apply now. But in order to apply this patch during runtime, the function must not be currently executed by some of the threads. And additionally, it may also not be on the call stack of a thread. We say it must not be active. For every single thread, this inactivity will be reached, for example, after the doWork call. In fact, this point is suitable for a wide variety of patches. So, if a patch is pending, the worker thread waits in a barrier for all other workers to also reach this point. Now all threads are waiting in the barrier, and we call this a state of global quiescence. Finally, a dedicated patcher thread can apply the patch and afterwards resume the workers. This barrier method is state of the art when applying patches in multi-threaded user space processes. This is what it looks like when we actually apply a patch in OpenLDAP with this method of global quiescence. The first graph shows the response rate on the vertical axis during the time after a patch request, the blue line, and we see the rate drops to zero shortly after the patch request. After the patch completed, the backlog gets processed, thus the peak at shortly before 2.2 seconds. The second graph shows the maximum latencies. After the patch request, there's a phase with no latencies at all because the response rate dropped to zero. But after this, we observe a latency peak of about 150 milliseconds. So we see after the patch request, the performance decreases until a complete halt. Pretty bad. The reasons for this are long-running calculations, which prevent threads from reaching the barrier, and of course, also I/O operations, which may even be unbounded. An additional problem is inter-thread dependencies, which can lead to complete deadlocks. We do not observe this in OpenLDAP, but in MariaDB, where threads take locks during database transactions. Of course, this problem can be resolved, but requires a lot of knowledge about the application and can be easily made wrong. To conclude, these three problems make global quiescence bad for performance and also difficult to get right for the developer. So, what can we do to prevent this? What do kernel patching solutions do? Well, kSlice, for example, repeatedly probes for quiescence instead of waiting in a barrier and blocking. This might work well for kernel, where most of the time should be spent in user space anyway, but is problematic for user space itself, because quiescence may never be reached and the patch may never get applied. A more advanced solution is used by kcraft, which installs the patched version of a function in parallel to the old one and decides on a per-thread basis which one to use. This basically reduces global quiescence to thread local quiescence. But kcraft has some disadvantages too. It is restricted to a certain patching methodology, that is via function indirections, because of the old and the new versions must exist in parallel, and depends on features like debug breakpoints and interprocessor interrupts to ensure atomicity. In addition, it poses a performance penalty due to the function call indirections. So we want to keep the basic idea of patching threads independently from each other, that is using thread local quiescence, but without the kernel patching specific restrictions. Our solution to this is weight-free code patching via address-based generations. In this work, we developed a kernel extension where we exploit virtual memory in order to provide multiple views of an address space with slight differences. We call them address-based generations as they represent different patching states of the process. With this, we are able to define quiescence thread locally and migrate the threads individually to newer address-based generations. We built this extension for the Linux kernel. Now let's look at the measurements again. This is what global quiescence looked like in OpenLDAP. And with our weight-free approach, we do not observe any change in the response rate during the patching. Also, for the maximum latency, we cannot observe a significant change either when using local quiescence. In addition to this, deadlocks caused by inter-thread dependencies are not a problem anymore. We do not have to handle these kinds of situations anymore because threads are never blocking on a quiescence barrier. Well, how does this work? Initially, every process, of course, has a single address space with code and data segments. There's a part in a text segment that we want to patch. With our weight-free extension, the kernel provides a new system call, weight-free create, which clones the whole address space similar to fork, but unlike fork, the clone remains inside the current process and the memory areas are shared between the clones and do not have a copy and write behavior. Another fundamental difference to fork is that also mapping changes are synchronized. That means creation of new mappings, deletion, or modification of access rights always affect all clones. So on a logical level, the clones or address-based generations resemble the same address space. However, as we want to patch the code, there must be an exception to this. With weight-free pin, we can define memory mappings which will not be shared among the generations, but use an ordinary copy and write behavior instead. This must be done before the first call to weight-free create. Now we are able to apply the patch to the buggy region in the new generation only. Initially, of course, all the threads live in the first generation. With another new system call, weight-free migrate, we can move them to the new generation. All the threads are still in the same process and can communicate through the shared mappings. Of course, it is also possible to delete a generation. One restriction that you may already see here is that it is currently not possible to patch data structures or the interpretation of data with this approach. We are restricted to code-only patches. The reason for this is that all the data is shared by the threads in all generations, so this will conflict when multiple threads with a differing patching state access the same data. Back to the OpenLDAP example. How do we apply weight-free patching here? This was the method of global quiescence, and to convert it to local quiescence, the patcher thread simply creates a new address-based generation, migrates to this new generation, and applies the patch without affecting the workers. When that's done, the workers will migrate when each of them reaches its local quiescence point. A side note, every global quiescence point can automatically also be used as a local quiescence point, but there are additional local quiescence points. Thus, local quiescence is often easier and sometimes also faster to reach for each thread. Let's have a more detailed look at our implementation in Linux. An address space is represented by a memory map structure in the kernel, and the mappings are backed by pages. Wait for create is simple. We duplicate the memory map as we do in fork. Both clones point to the same underlying pages, of course. We do not have them in copy and write mode, as in fork, but in a shared memory configuration. Except, of course, both pages belonging to the previously pinned regions, so they can diverge in case of modification. Wait for migrate just changes a thread's memory map pointer and performs a context switch. This is simple, as each thread already possesses its own memory map pointer in Linux. Mapping changes, however, are more difficult, as we want to keep the address space generations in sync. Every action that changes the anatomy of the address space must be not only executed on the current memory map, but also on all its siblings. For example, unmapping a region in one generation must also unmap the corresponding region in all other generations. Therefore, we had to adapt all the system calls and kernel functions that do mapping changes to apply these changes for all the address space clones. A problem occurs when extending an anonymous mapping, like the heap, for example. This does not immediately create underlying pages in the Linux kernel. Instead, these are assigned lazily by page faults. This also requires synchronization between the clones. We could copy the pages to all generations immediately in case of such a page fault. However, that would likely be a performance bottleneck. Instead, we decided to resolve this in a lazy fashion too. We make the initial memory map special and call it the master memory map. All paging operations are always first executed on this memory map, except of course for pinned regions. Now, in case of a page fault, the other generations do first consult the master memory map and copy its page table entries if already existing. This ensures a consistent view of lazily initialized page ranges. As a consequence, the master memory map cannot be deleted and stays alive during the whole lifetime of the process. We also use the master memory map as a locking proxy for all the generations. The kernel extension is about 2000 lines of code, including changes and deletions, and is currently based on Linux 5.1. We tested it on AMD 64. How did we evaluate our approach? Therefore, we chose 6 widely used server applications to apply live patches to: OpenLDAP, the Apache web server, Memcached, Samba, MariaDB, and Node.js. To get suitable patches, we took the versions of these applications from Debian 10 and looked at all the patches that the Debian maintainers provided. The numbers in the parentheses denote critical patches that are connected to a CVE. Because we support code-only patches only, we had to throw away all the patches that modify data structures. As you can see, there still remain 87% of the patches, and even more security-relevant patches. In order to get binary patches that we can apply during runtime, we used a modified version of kpatch. Kpatch is one of the patching solutions for the Linux kernel, and we wrote a small user space library that can apply the patches that kpatch generates in user space. The library is also capable of employing local quiescence with our Waitree kernel extension, as well as global quiescence via the standard barrier method. In the case of MariaDB and Node.js, as you can see, we lose a lot of patches as these applications are written in C++, which does not work very well with kpatch. All other code-only patches could be applied. In order to compare our wait-free approach to the state-of-the-art global quiescent method, we measured the request latencies on a client connected to the server under high load, while we repeatedly either establish global quiescence via a barrier or alternatively use the wait-free approach. We repeated this measurement 1000 times for every benchmark target. Let's look at the results of OpenLDAP in more detail. On the vertical axis, we have the number of requests using a logarithmic scale. And on the horizontal axis, you can see the bin request latencies. The red one on the top is global quiescence. The bottom graph shows the result of the wait-free approach. Typically, the latencies range from 0 to 40 milliseconds. But in global quiescence, we can observe a tail of long-running requests at around 140 milliseconds, caused by the barrier. This is not the case with local quiescence. For MariaDB, we see an even more extreme result. Here, the request latencies for global quiescence are more evenly distributed, reaching above 1 second. Whereas with wait-free patching, the 99.5 percentile is even below 8 milliseconds. These are the overhead numbers of the wait-free patching extension. The creation of a new address space generation ranged from 88 microseconds in MengPhD to about 2 milliseconds in Node.js. Migration between address space generations is very fast and was between 5 to 8 microseconds. In terms of memory, we have a permanent penalty during the runtime of a process caused by the permanent master memory map that cannot be deleted. But this is only for processes that at least call wait-free create once, so processes that use our wait-free kernel extension. For our benchmark targets, this was up to 1,800 kilobytes, depending on the complexity of the address space anatomy. In this work, we successfully used address space generations for wait-free code patching. However, we believe that the mechanism of synchronized address space clones with partial differences could also be used for other applications. For example, we could combine the method with a JIT compiler and enable concurrent recompilation without having to change pointers to the code. Similarly, the method could also be used in kernel space and allow path-specific optimizations like synthesis did. We could use the mechanism to support dynamic variability management and combine this with our previous research in this field. And finally, we could use address-based views to isolate critical data between threads. This is not a new idea, of course, but our mechanism has some advantages over pre-existent methods where the address spaces do diverge from each other as in fork. Apart from this, we believe that it may be a good idea to further decouple the concepts of processes and address spaces in the kernel. This does not only serve our approach, but might also promote other ideas and development. To wrap up, in this work we presented wait-free code patching via address-based generations. The goal is to reduce global quiescence to local quiescence, which is often easier to establish and enables us to maintain quality of service during applying a patch. The approach to establish local quiescence is allowing a process to have multiple address-based clones, which are kept in sync with each other. We evaluated our approach with 6 server applications. We were able to apply code patches during the runtime and improve tail latencies during the patching process. That's it from my side. Thank you very much for your attention. You'll find the paper, source code, and artifacts on our website. I'm looking forward to answer your questions in the live session, or of course, you can also contact me or my colleagues by email.